P42 here. Sir Isaac Newton is universally regarded as one of the most brilliant men who ever lived. During his 84 years on God's green earth, he did more than perhaps anyone else before or since to further our understanding of this crazy universe we live in. In a book titled The 100, published in 1978, Newton ranks as the second most influential person in history, putting him one place above Jesus Christ, the actual Son of God. Many of history's luminaries were only fully appreciated after their deaths, but not Newton. He was a legend in his own lifetime. A force of nature whose superhuman intellect illuminated the darkest recesses of human knowledge. Knighted by Queen Anne in 1705, he later became the first scientist buried in Westminster Abbey, a final resting place traditionally reserved for the monarchy. It was the scientific equivalent of sainthood. All of this is, of course, common knowledge. When you're one of the greatest thinkers in history, word of your achievements tends to get around. But there's another side to the knighted Newton that you didn't learn about in school. A shadowy Mr. Hyde to the genius Dr. Jekyll. You see, Newton spent decades of his life conducting top secret research that even his closest colleagues and confidants knew nothing about. And there was good reason for that. Because had anyone known what Newton was really up to behind closed doors, he probably would have been locked up, perhaps even hanged. His descendants considered this clandestine research to be so dangerous that they buried it for centuries. When it eventually resurfaced, more than 200 years after his death, it unveiled the unexpectedly dark shadows cast by one of science's brightest lights. This is the untold story of Sir Isaac Newton, a scientist, mathematician, genius, and heretical alchemist. Like the man he pipped to second spot on the list of the 100 most influential people in history, Newton was born on Christmas Day. The birth of a child is typically one of a family's most joyous events, but Newton's was a little bit different. His father, also called Isaac, had died 3 months earlier, and Isaac Jr. arrived several months ahead of schedule. He was so tiny when he gulped his first breath of earthly air that his mother claimed he could fit inside a quart mug. Hopefully someone from America can tell me what the hell that actually means in the comments. If Newton's birth was bad, his childhood wasn't much better. When he was just 3 years of age, his mother left the family home to shack up with the rector of a nearby village, abandoning Isaac to the care of his grandparents. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Newton would grow up hating his stepfather's God-fearing guts, and his relationship with his mother suffered as a result. Oddly enough, Newton wasn't actually such a great student as a youngster. He only started taking his studies seriously after deciding the best way to prove his worth to his many bullies was to show them that he was smarter than them. It's fair to say that went pretty well. Still, had history taken a slightly different course, Newton might never have become the giga genius he ultimately did. Because, in 1658, his mother pulled him out of school and tried to force him to take over the family farm. Luckily for us, Newton's schoolmaster managed to change her mind, and the young genius ended up at Cambridge, where he delved into the fields of science and mathematics, rather than actual fields. The rest, as they say, is history. By 24, Newton had established the fundamentals of calculus, discovered the complex multicolored nature of light, and started work on what would one day become the universal theory of gravity. At an age where most of us are still figuring out how to work the washing machine, Isaac Newton had fundamentally altered humanity's understanding of life, the universe, and everything. Had he made just one of these breakthroughs in his career, he would have gone down in history as one of the most important scientists of the age. The fact he made all three, and countless others besides, is why we consider Newton to be perhaps the most important scientist of any era. And that's pretty much how he was viewed for a good 200 years after his death. But On the 13th of July 1936, the world got its first glimpse of an altogether different side of this saintly scientist. That was the day the brilliantly named Gerard Vernon Wallop, known to his mates as the 9th Earl of Portsmouth, put the contents of a large metallic chest up for auction at Sotheby's in London. The junk in this metallic trunk consisted of thousands of pages of handwritten notes by Newton himself. These never-before-seen manuscripts containing a colossal 10 million words represented the sum total of Newton's life work. But barely anyone knew they existed before that day. Newton died without a will, and the wealth of his writings wandered to his relatives, who, after scanning the contents, decided it was best for everyone if the manuscripts disappeared. If you're wondering what convinced the 9th Earl of Portsmouth to break with 200 years of family tradition by offering Newton's papers up for public auction, the answer is simple. He was broke. 10 million words straight from the pen of the greatest scientist in history should have been priceless. But oddly, the auction attracted scant attention. For some reason, the folks at Sotheby's did bugger all to advertise the sale, and ultimately, Newton's life work was sold piecemeal to dozens of different collectors for the paltry sum of just £9,000. Amongst the buyers that day was legendary economist John Maynard Keynes. He turned up late, having only heard about the marginally marketed auction at the last minute, and as a result, he was only able to snag around 10% of the papers. But what he discovered in those pages was so remarkable, he spent the final decade of his life trying to track down the rest. Despite Newton's reputation as one of the greatest scientists and mathematicians in history, those subjects accounted for less than a third of the writings he left behind. In other words, all that invention of calculus and discovery of the laws of gravity business was basically a side hobby he dabbled in when he wasn't working on his real interests, namely religion and alchemy. Of the two, the former would have been the most controversial in Newton's time, because the roughly 5 million words he dedicated to the subject of religion revealed views that the Christian church would have considered nothing short of heretical. Newton was a closet anti-Trinitarian, meaning he rejected the idea of a God separated into the three equal parts of the Holy Trinity. According to Newton, Jesus Christ was just another man, and worshipping him was tantamount to idolatry. In 17th century England, that was a very dangerous viewpoint indeed. People had been executed for far less. Despite his radical religious ideas, Newton was a deeply spiritual man and devout Christian. He was also a bit of an egotist, believing he'd been handpicked by God himself to reveal ancient wisdom hidden in the Bible. For years, he fixated on finding the fabled Bible Code, a hidden cipher that would reveal long-lost knowledge about the nature of the universe. In a manuscript dating to 1704, Newton used clues he found in the Old Testament's Book of Daniel to scientifically calculate the timing of the apocalypse. Though unable to pinpoint a precise date, he did predict it would come sooner than 2060. I can't decide if that's comforting or terrifying. Newton's religious views may have been heretical, but his alchemical interests were very much illegal. Practitioners of alchemy, an antiquated arm of natural philosophy, sought to transform base metals into gold, seek a miracle cure-all concoction, or brew the elusive elixir of life, which was basically Red Bull, but if you drank it, you'd live forever. Alchemy was a pinch of proto-chemistry, a smattering of sorcery, and a massive dollop of delusional bullshit. But Sir Isaac Newton was absolutely bloody mad for it. Amongst the papers auctioned in 1936 was a detailed description of how to make something called Sophic Mercury, which in Newton's day was believed to be a precursor to the Philosopher's Stone, the key to eternal life. Newton conducted countless experiments over the course of 30 years as a dedicated alchemist, And whilst he was never successful in transmuting lead into gold, his alchemical obsession may have had an unexpected but profound effect on his life and legacy. More on that in a moment. Oh, and if you're still wondering exactly why alchemy was illegal in Newton's day, allow me to explain. If someone ever figured out how to turn base metals into gold, they would have the power to single-handedly break the entire English economy. Nobody knew for certain if transmutation was actually possible, but in 1404, Henry IV made some aspects of alchemy punishable by death, just to be on the safe side. Whilst Newton's more outlandish studies were almost entirely unknown to the outside world until the auction in 1936, even in his own time, he had a bit of a reputation for being, well, a bit odd. He was an introverted child and a reclusive adult with very few friends. At 19, he confessed all his sins in a letter he wrote to none other than God himself. Whilst most were laughably innocuous, like squirting water on a Sunday, I'm definitely going to hell if that one counts, others reveal a darker side to the scientific saint of the 17th century. Amongst his 57 sins, Newton confessed to punching his sister, fighting, wishing various people dead, and threatening to burn his parents' house down whilst they were still inside. Lovely. Newton also had a famously volatile relationship with many of his fellow scientists. Probably his most famous dispute was with German polymath Gottfried Leibniz, who Newton believed had plagiarized his development of calculus. The bitter feud spanned years and turned pretty nasty, prompting the prestigious Royal Society to intervene. In a long and detailed report published in 1713, the Society ruled in Newton's favour. But there was a catch. Newton just so happened to be the president of the Royal Society at the time, and he wrote the entire scathing report himself without ever bothering to ask Leibniz for his version of events. Incidentally, most modern scholars now believe Newton and Leibniz developed calculus entirely independently, so it was all a lot of fuss about nothing. As a professor, Newton taught at Cambridge University for some 30 years, but he had little interest in passing on his knowledge to the next generation. He made no effort to dumb things down for the mere mortals taking his classes. And his lectures were so impenetrable that most of his students didn't even bother to turn up. Not that Newton minded. According to legend, he delivered his lectures regardless of whether or not anyone was actually there to hear them. Newton's famously erratic behaviour only intensified with age, and in 1692 he had a full-blown nervous breakdown. For 18 months he battled insomnia, mental confusion, tremors, digestive issues, memory maladies, and paranoid delusions. Modern Newton scholars have speculated that he may have suffered from one or more conditions, bipolar disorder, depression, Asperger's syndrome, and schizophrenia. But it may also be the case that Newton's secret research contributed to his psychological imbalance. Because those symptoms I just mentioned, insomnia, confusion, digestive issues, they're all signs of mercury poisoning. Mercury was an important substance to alchemists, and Newton would have used it in many of his experiments. Being the thorough and slightly balmy scientist that he was, he even tasted it along with over 100 metals, including arsenic and lead. To add a little extra weight to the heavy metal poisoning theory, on his death at the grand old age of 84, Newton's hair was found to contain extremely high concentrations of mercury. In his mid-50s, Newton was appointed warden to the Royal Mint. The role was supposed to be symbolic, more a sign of status than an actual job, but Newton had other ideas. To the extreme annoyance of his new colleagues, he took his purely symbolic job incredibly seriously, bowling in like Elon Musk at Twitter and making wholesale changes designed to reduce corruption and inefficiency. Counterfeiting was a huge problem in England at the time, and Newton vigorously pursued the prosecution of those suspected of the crime. Rumour has it he even visited London's dodgier pubs in disguise in an attempt to gather evidence on local coin-based criminals. He was responsible for dozens of successful convictions, and many of those he brought to justice were hung, drawn, quartered, and finally disemboweled for their crimes. He continued to work diligently in this job that was never supposed to be a job for almost 30 years, only retiring when the Grim Reaper paid him a visit in the spring of 1727. History remembers Newton as the ultimate scientist, a pure intellect whose remarkable insights ushered mankind into a new era of understanding. And he certainly did exactly that. But like every other member of the species he did so much for, Newton was also a man. He made his fair share of mistakes and did battle with more than a few demons. And yes, he may have been a little bit different, but then again, perhaps you need to be if you want to change the world. Thanks for watching.